Good morning, my dear students. First of all, I welcome all of you for the first session on the bridge course for the first PU students. As you all know that because of this pandemic that is prevailing all over the world, we have not been able to take the live classes, and that is the reason that we thought of uploading some of the videos after recording it in the college about certain things or certain concepts and posting it to you by sending you the link, as I had already told you in my earlier video. So probably my face is familiar, I is what I feel, and yes, today let me start off with the first session, that is importance of communication or importance of English in science. Okay, now I am here to tell you about certain things about the English language. We all are here in India use something that is called as ESL. So English is always studied as a second language for all of us here. The reason for this is that we don't speak English as our mother tongue. Do we speak? No, right? We always speak our mother tongue, respective of our own religion, as our mother tongue. Isn't it? So that is the reason that in an Indian context, we always study English as a second language. So you should be aware of the fact that you have enrolled yourself for the 2 years of pre-university education, and now you are slowly stepping into college education. You have just finished your school education, you wrote your 10th exams, you got wonderful results, you got wonderful marks, and then you got admitted to the pre-university education where you will be studying for the next 2 years before going to a professional college, isn't it? So these 2 years will act as a very crucial for your career. So the importance of English is always been there. As you all know that in an Indian context, English is already, or English is always studied as a second language. Unlike Cambridge University examinations or O level or A levels, what we call it as ordinary level, which is nothing but 10th in Indian context, and A level, which is nothing but advanced level, which is plus 2. So to say, the course that you have enrolled to, isn't it? So when we are talking here about English as a second language, it is one of the compulsory subjects that you need to choose, isn't it? Now, in this pre-university education, you have 4 core subjects depending on your choice, whatever you have chosen, isn't it? So you have enrolled yourself for PCMB, which is biology, or you have enrolled yourself for PCMC, which is computer science. The rest 3 subjects are common, and the 4th core subject will change as per your choice, isn't it? So some of you have chosen biology as your one of the core subjects, or on the other hand, some of you have chosen computer science as your another core subject. Apart from these 4 subjects, you have an option of other 2 compulsory languages that you will have to opt for, isn't it? In which English is compulsory. So you have to choose English as a compulsory subject, and then you have a choice of choosing another language. In terms of, you can go for Kannada, you can go for Sanskrit, or you can go for Hindi, isn't it? I'm talking to you with respect to our college here with APJ Science Academy. We offer 3 other languages wherein you can choose whichever you are comfortable with. So the second language option will be there right in your application form, or it can be told to the office people to choose whichever the language that you would wish to go for. You can go for Kannada or Hindi or Sanskrit according to your choice. But on the other hand, English is something that is a compulsory language that you have to choose in here. Now, let me tell you certain myths about this language. Most of us are of the opinion that English is a language which can be studied where it is very difficult to get out of out marks, unlike the other core subjects that you have come out with. Right? But if you understand English, if you do practical in knowledge, if you apply this practical knowledge in terms of answering the questions with correct punctuation, spellings, sentence structures, and then understanding the grammar concept very well in your mind and applying it in your question paper, of course there are chances wherein you can score good marks. Okay, so that is something about the subject that you are going to come in here with. But today in my session, I'm just going to tell you something about why English is required, why English is essential in the science. Why is it essential? The first thing is that apart from English, all other four core subjects that you're going to study as per your choice will have to be definitely answered in English only, isn't it? So you definitely need to have a knowledge in comprehending English according to where is your stand in the language. So that is why we say something about ESL, English as a second language. Okay, so here English is taught and studied as a second language. Why? Because India is a non-native English speaking country, isn't it? India is a non-native. We are all called as the non-native speakers. On the other hand, you have certain countries around the world where they are called as the native speakers of English. Why? Because by birth, they have been comprehending, they have been studying, they have been speaking English as their mother tongue. What's the first thing, or what's the first country that comes to your mind the moment you think of English? England, isn't it? Yes. When we talk about a country like England, they were the people who brought us the language. Go back to the history. As you have studied social science in the previous class of yours, where they had, you know, ruled us for 200 long years in terms of getting their language to us. So slowly we started learning English from British, isn't it? Because they ruled us for, you know, so many years. Pre-independent era of India, you know it very well, isn't it? So that's why English is a language that has come to us through Britishers, isn't it? As and when the time went on, okay, you were tend to see other countries also had English, but they never came to the countries to rule unlike British, isn't it? So we call that particular term as colonization, isn't it? I hope you have heard of this word colonization, especially with respect to the social science that you have studied, isn't it? In the similar way, as the time went on, we came to know that, yeah, there is something which is called as British English. Then there is something that is also called as American accent, American English, so to say. Isn't it? And a Canadian, for that matter, will speak or will have his own language in the form of the way he speaks. And very recently, we also have something that is called as Australian English. The people from New Zealand. Okay. If you take an example of an European Union, countries like, you know, England and Scotland, there is a lot of difference between how a British speaks English and how a person from Scotland speaks English. So it all depends because of the geographical locations that we live in. On a nutshell, on a broader way, we all think that it is British English and American English. This is how we normally have studied language in two terms of, or in the two ways of, you know, the language that has been come to us in the form of learning from the foreigners. Isn't it? Now, I'd like to just give you an example here. Like earlier in our school, we were taught by our teacher that the spelling of the word color is C-O-L-O-U-R. Isn't it? Now, if the same word, if you are using a Microsoft Word document and typing it as C-O-L-O-U-R, it will show you some error in it. And when you go and click on that, when you go and click on the right side of the mouse button, it will show you, or it will take you, that the word is misspelled and you will have to write it as C-O-L-O-R. So which one is correct? Both are correct, but we have categorized it, isn't it? We have categorized it in the form of British English, American English, isn't it? So that's not the thing. The language, or whichever English that you are going to follow for that matter, okay? I'll give you one more example here, like, you know, colonization. Colonization. Here, Z is replaced as S. Nothing but an example or a difference between what is British English and what is American way of English that they learn, they spell, they pronounce. So what we need to understand here is that we just need to go to the content here, isn't it? For example, if you are looking up for a word, meaning of a word in a dictionary, okay, if you are looking for a meaning of a word, for example, S-T-E-A-L, stealth, what does it mean? What is the meaning of this word? So if I ask you the question, those who know the meaning, they can very well say that this is what it is. This is the meaning of the word or something. Those who have heard the meaning of the word or the word for the first time will definitely try to understand what could be the meaning here. So they would ask in turn the tutor or the facilitator about, give us some context so that we can try to understand the meaning of the word. So the teacher tries to demonstrate the context related to this word, isn't it? For example, stealth. If I have to give you a situation here to understand what do you mean by stealth, okay? So I give you this situation. So there is a very big wild forest, okay? There, you find a tiger. You find a tiger, a ferocious tiger, okay? And then a tiger in a wild forest will always depend on its prey, isn't it? Which word do you think is the tiger depends in a jungle or in a forest? It always depends on its prey. It depends on its prey there, isn't it? Not this prey, isn't it? Now, when you start learning language, you come to know so many syntaxes like this, which you have talked about, which you have heard before. So these words, which are pronounced in the same way, with different spellings, also with different meanings in a word, they are called as homophones in English. I'm sure you have studied this, isn't it? So if I ask you to make a list of the homophones that are available in English, I'm sure you all will do that, isn't it? A word which is pronounced in the same way but having different spellings and different meanings altogether is called as a homophone, isn't it? Now, I'm giving you a context here or a situation to understand the word stealth. So a ferocious tiger in a jungle, okay, is dependent on the prey for its survival, isn't it? Now assume a situation, there is a tiger, okay, far off distance or something. The tiger gets to notice that the prey is grazing in the jungle. It can be a deer, okay, it can be a deer or something. So when deer is grazing in the field, which is the prey for this tiger, okay, how do you think that the tiger will walk towards its prey? How do you think it will walk? Do you think it will straight away go and catch its prey and kill and start eating it? No. Why? Because it will walk very stealthily. Isn't it? I make this word as an adverb and I add stealthily, okay? The tiger is walking stealthily towards its prey. If I give you this as a context, or if I give you this as a sentence, by now I'm sure you can identify or you can come to know what exactly the meaning of this word is, isn't it? Stealthily, that is, the tiger, after noticing or after looking that there is a prey in a very far off place or a very nearby place or something, so the tiger will walk with very light footsteps, isn't it? It will go very clandestine. I can give you so many synonyms for this word, which is called as stealth. So what I mean to tell you here is that language is something which will come to us through practice, through reading, isn't it? So one of the main aspects of any language for that matter is nothing but how good you are at the skills like L, S, R, W. How good you are at listening, how good you are at speaking, how good you are at reading, and how good you are at writing. So that is why if you want to learn any language, this L, S, R, W skills are very, very important. Okay, so students, with this context, I'm sure you might have your own words of understanding what is the meaning of the word stealth. Coming on to this part of the word, I have told you what do they mean, or what do they call, what are they called as in the language context. So they are called as the homophones or something. In the similar way, whichever the word that you take in English, it will have three main things associated with the similar word in it, for example. So those set of words are nothing but homonyms and homophones. You should know the difference, you should know the examples, you should know the definitions, isn't it? You know about antonyms and synonyms in English. What is an antonym and what is a synonym, isn't it? In the similar way, a word which is added at the beginning of a word which is added at the end of the word, something that is called as prefixes and suffixes in English, isn't it? So these are the words that you will have to always understand, because any word in English can be broadly classified into a homophone or a homonym. It can be a prefix or it can be a suffix, or you should be knowing what is the antonym part of that word or what is the synonym part of the word or something, isn't it? Now this is a basic idea that you need to understand when you start learning the language, isn't it? As you all know that communication is a two-way process, isn't it? So there is an instructor, there are the listeners. So it should be a two-way process that has to aim at something that is called understanding, isn't it? Now, this English today has emerged as a universal language. Do you agree with me? Today, English is considered as a universal language. It is considered as the global language. Wherever you go, whichever the part of the world you be there in, If you know English, I'm sure you can survive. Isn't it? So I would like to quote you one example here, like, you know, some 2 decades back or something, if you see, like, you know, when you were very small or something, okay, at that particular point of time, the countries like China or Japan or Brazil, for that matter, were having their own languages. For them, for Germany, German language. For the people of France, it was only French. For the people of Russia, it was only Russian. For the people of China, it was only Chinese. For people of Japan, it was only Japanese. But when English started becoming the global language, the people of that specific particular countries, they started realizing that, yes, English is now emerging as a global language. So obviously, this will be our duty that we will also have to learn English. Isn't it? Now, the people who ignored English today are the top players in the world because they have very easy access to English. English is taught in the classes. English is a kind of official language for them, apart from their mother tongue, so to say. Isn't it? In today's scenario, Chinese is a national language for them, but at the same time, they give so much importance to English as well. Japan, for that matter, Japanese was their official language, and even as per with the official language of Japanese, even they have the importance of learning English as a language. A similar case with a developing country like India is also the same, which is our national language, you all know it. But India is a country which is a democrat, isn't it? It's a democratic country where you have innumerable languages that are available, isn't it? So if you go to any part of India, you know how they speak and what the language that they use in terms of something that is called as mother tongue. Isn't it? So India has so many different mother tongues that are spoken widely, but you also study English as a language. But as I said in my earlier discussion, English is always studied in India as a second language. Okay, now having said that, why English is required in order to understand science? In today's session, I'll just discuss some 2 examples from one of your main core subjects, physics. Okay? I'm sure all of you know Albert Einstein, isn't it? The moment you think of physics, the first thing that may come into your mind is obviously Albert Einstein, isn't it? So when you talk about Einstein's theory of relativity, yeah, when you talk about this term, particularly theory of relativity, you have your own way of understanding what does it mean, isn't it? You definitely have to read the book, read the theory, then only you will be able to understand it. But do you know that this theory of relativity was actually written in German? Isn't it? It was actually written in German. But even if today, in present day, if you think that this theory was just remained without being translated to any other language, if it was there only in German language, what would have been the situation? Most of us would have learnt the theory of relativity by learning German first. But no, English was having its own importance since then, isn't it? That is the reason that this theory of relativity, which was mainly written in German, is today has been translated to so many different languages throughout the world. And that is how, when it was translated to English, we came to know what exactly is the theory is all about. Okay, there are different ways of understanding this theory. If you say theory of relativity, you're talking about the relativity theory of relativity. So the use of prepositions in English always plays a very, very important role in understanding the language, isn't it? For example, instead of if you had for here, theory for relativity, the meaning is quite different there, isn't it? So that is why marking of prepositions in the language plays a very, very important role. So this is one example related to one of the subjects that you are going to study, that is physics. Okay, now I would like to tell you one more example here about physics is all about theory, problems and experiments, isn't it? You all agree with me, I'm sure, for that. Right, when you're talking about, just say for example, you are comprehending a question which says like the mass of object, okay, the mass of object is decreased to 25% of its original, of its original value. Okay, how do you understand this sentence? Mass of object is decreased to 25% of its original value. Okay, now I'll just make a very small change here. Okay, just have your own way of understanding this sentence. Mass of object is decreased to 25% of its original value. So you have a sentence, you read it and you understood in your own way. Okay, now what I do is that, what language can do to science is that, if I take this word to here and if I say by, okay, now to and by, mass of object is decreased by 25% of its original value. So you know what is the difference here. My dear students, you need to have a concept very well understood in your minds in order to work or in order to experiment or in order to understand the theories, any theories for that matter. I've just taken here an example of just the physics here. See, when you say mass of the object is decreased to 25% means decreased to some 50% of the weightage, isn't it? But when you say the mass of the object is decreased by 25%, what is left? 75% more is left. Isn't it? In the similar way, you got to understand the concept in a broader sense, and that gives you only the opt knowledge that you have in English. If the problems, if the studies or if the theories or if the experiments are very well understood with terms of the language that is used in the concepts, it will be kept in your mind for a longer time. Till life you will not forget it, isn't it? So that is why one should always have the importance to the language, to the words, to the syntaxes that are used in any problems. You can have similar examples in mathematics. You can have similar examples in chemistry. You can have similar examples in biology as well. But what is the main thing? The main thing is understanding the core concept in terms of the language that you are going to read, write, listen and speak, isn't it? So that is why English becomes very, very important. Okay, so I'm sure you all have enough ample knowledge on learning English. Okay, but once you are into this system of education where you are preparing yourself for the professional colleges for your future after this 2 years of your education, you should definitely comprehend the skills and you should definitely imbibe these English learning skills as a platform wherein you learn, you put it into practice. So what we do in our college is that you learn English language in such a way that theory, put it into practical. So in order to have these kinds of things, one should be very good at the comprehending skills. You should have good vocabulary, you should have good attitude towards your fellow mates, you should have good communication skills with you, you should be confident enough. Okay, so what was happening in the school education was that probably all your learning was something that was stipulated to a classroom. But in pre-university education, we see to it that you have been given an enough platform here to showcase your skills in English in terms of communication, in terms of presentation, in terms of speaking, in terms of reading, writing and listening skills, which will definitely make you a good communicator. So with this, students, I wind up my session on the importance of English in any of the science courses. So you can watch this video again and again and just try to understand what is my point. Okay, why am I stressing you people in terms of having importance to language as well? Okay, so with this, I just wind up my session and I'll meet you with another session on coming on to the general English. Like, you know, what exactly are you going to study and how exactly you will be studying in our college, especially when it comes to a language that is English. Thank you.